بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم ارحمني بترك المعاصي أبدا ما أبقيتني، وارحمني أن أتكلف ما لا يعنيني، وارزقني حسن النظر فيما يرضيك عني. اللهم بديع السماوات والأرض ذا الجلال والإكرام والعزة التي لا ترام، أسألك يا الله يا رحمن بجلالك ونور وجهك أن تلزم قلبي حفظ كتابك كما علمتني، وارزقني أن أتلوه على النحو الذي يرضيك عني. اللهم بديع السماوات والأرض ذا الجلال والإكرام والعزة التي لا ترام، أسألك يا الله يا رحمن بجلالك ونور وجهك أن تنور بكتابك بصري، وأن تطلق به لساني، وأن تفرج به عن قلبي، وأن تشرح به صدري، وأن تستعمل به بدني، فإنه لا يعينني على الحق غيرك، ولا يؤتيه إلا أنت، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. اللهم إني أتوب إليك من المعاصي لا أرجع إليها أبدا، اللهم مغفرتك أوسع من ذنوبي، ورحمتك أرجى عندي من عملي. اللهم إنك عفو تحب العفو فاعف عني. اللهم اكفني بحلالك عن حرامك، وأغنني بفضلك عمن سواك. اللهم فارج الهم كاشف الغم مجيب دعوة المضطرين، رحمن الدنيا والآخرة ورحيمهما، أنت ترحمني فارحمني برحمة تغنيني بها عن رحمة من سواك. اللهم رب السماوات والأرض عالم الغيب والشهادة، إني أعهد إليك في هذه الحياة الدنيا أني أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت وحدك لا شريك لك، وأن محمدا صلى الله عليه وسلم عبدك ورسولك، فلا تكلني إلى نفسي، فإنك إن تكلني إلى نفسي تقربني من الشر وتباعدني من الخير، وإني لا أثق إلا برحمتك، فاجعل لي عندك عهدا توفينيه يوم القيامة، إنك لا تخلف الميعاد. أستغفر الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الحي القيوم وأتوب إليه. رب اغفر لي وتب علي، إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من العجز والكسل والجبن والهرم والمغرم والمأثم. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من عذاب النار وفتنة النار وفتنة القبر وعذاب القبر، وشر فتنة الغنى وشر فتنة الفقر، وأعوذ بك من القسوة والغفلة والعيلة والذلة والمسكنة، وأعوذ بك من الفقر والكفر والفسوق والشقاق والسمعة والرياء، وأعوذ بك من الصمم والبكم والبرص والجنون والجذام وسيء الأسقام. اللهم إني أعوذ بعزتك لا إله إلا أنت أن تذلني، أنت الحي لا تموت والجن والإنس يموتون. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من جهد البلاء ودرق الشقاء وسوء القضاء وشماتة الأعداء. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من شر ما علمت ومن شر ما لم أعلم. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من شر ما عملت ومن شر ما لم أعمل. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من زوال نعمتك وتحول عافيتك وفجاءة نقمتك وجميع سخطك. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من شر سمعي ومن شر بصري ومن شر لساني ومن شر قلبي ومن شر مني. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من الهدم والتردي، وأعوذ بك من الغرق والحرق والهرم، وأعوذ بك أن يتخطبني الشيطان عند الموت، وأعوذ بك أن أموت في سبيلك مدبرا، وأعوذ بك أن أموت لدغا. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من منكرات الأخلاق والأعمال والأهواء والأدواء. اللهم إني أسألك من خير ما سألك منه نبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وأعوذ بك من شر ما استعاذ منه نبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. وأنت المستعان وعليك البلاغ، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من جار السوء في دار المقامة، فإن جار البادية يتحول، ومن الجوع فإنه بئس الضجيع، ومن الخيانة فإنها بئسة البطانة. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من علم لا ينفع، وقلب لا يخشع، ودعاء لا يسمع، ونفس لا تشبع، ومن هؤلاء الأربع. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك أن نرجع على أعقابنا أو نفتن عن ديننا. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من يوم السوء، ومن ليلة السوء، ومن ساعة السوء، ومن صاحب السوء، ومن جار السوء في دار المقامة. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من الشقاق والنفاق وسوء الأخلاق. اللهم اغفر لي جدي وهزلي وخطئي وعمدي وكل ذلك عندي. اللهم مصرف القلوب، صرف قلوبنا على طاعتك. اللهم إني أسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى. رب أعني ولا تعن علي، وانصرني ولا تنصر علي، وامكر لي ولا تمكر علي، واهدني الهدى ويسر للهدى، وانصرني على من بغى علي. رب اجعلني لك ذكارا، لك شكارا، لك رهابا، لك مطواعا، لك مخبتا، إليك أواها منيبا. رب تقبل توبتي، واغسل حوبتي، وأجب دعوتي، وثبت حجتي، وسدد لساني، واهد قلبي، واسلل سخيمة صدري. اللهم اغفر لنا وارحمنا، وارض عنا، وتقبل منا، وادخلنا الجنة، ونجنا من النار، وأصلح لنا شأننا كله. اللهم إني أسألك الثبات في الأمر، وأسألك عزيمة الرشد، وأسألك شكر نعمتك وحسن عبادك، وأسألك لسانا صادقا، وقلبا سليما، وخلقا مستقيما. وأعوذ بك من شر ما تعلم، وأسألك من خير ما تعلم، وأستغفرك مما تعلم، إنك أنت علام الغيوب. اللهم ألف بين قلوبنا، وأصلح ذات بيننا، واهدنا سبل السلام، ونجنا من الظلمات إلى النور، وجنبنا الفواحش ما ظهر منها وما بطن، وبارك لنا في أسماعنا وبصارنا وقلوبنا وأزواجنا وذرياتنا، وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. واجعلنا شاكرين لنعمتك، مثنين بها، قابليها، وأتمها علينا. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيك، ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك، ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا. ومتعنا بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقواتنا ما أحييتنا، واجعله الوارث منا، واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا، وانصرنا على من عادانا، ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا، ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا، ولا تسلط علينا من لا يرحمنا. اللهم زدنا ولا تنقصنا، وأكرمنا ولا تهنا، وأعطنا ولا تحرمنا، وآثرنا ولا تؤثر علينا، وارضنا وارض عنا. اللهم ألهمني رشدي، وأعذني من شر نفسي. اللهم إني أسألك فعل الخيرات، وترك المنكرات، وحب المساكين، وأن تغفر لي وترحمني. وإذا أردت بقوم فتنة فتوفني غير مفتون. اللهم إني أسألك حبك وحب من يحبك، والعمل الذي يبلغني حبك. اللهم اجعل حبك أحب إلي من نفسي وأهلي ومن الماء البارد. اللهم ارزقني حبك وحب من ينفعني حبه عندك. اللهم فكما رزقتني مما أحب فاجعله قوة لي فيما تحب. اللهم وما زويت عني مما أحب فاجعله فراغا لي فيما تحب. يا مقلب القلوب، ثبت قلبي على دينك. اللهم إني أسألك إيمانا لا يرتد، ونعيما لا ينفذ، ومرافقة نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم في أعلى درجة الجنة الخلد. اللهم انفعني بما علمتني، وعلمني ما ينفعني، وزدني علما. الحمد لله على كل حال، وأعوذ بالله من حال أهل النار.
الله أكبر، الله أكبر، الله أكبر، الله أكبر. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله، أشهد أن لا إله إلا أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح الصلاة خير من النوم الصلاة خير من النوم الله أكبر الله أكبر لا
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح قد قامت الصلاة قد قامت الصلاة الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
قموا صفوفكم واعتدلوا Please make sure your heels are on the blue tape
الله أكبر الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين الأخلاء يومئذ بعضهم لبعض عدو إلا المتقين يا عبادي لا خوف عليكم اليوم ولا أنتم تحزنون الذين آمنوا بآياتنا وكانوا مسلمين أدخلوا الجنة أنتم وأزواجكم تحبرون يطاف عليهم بصحاف من ذهب وأكواب وفيها ما تشتهيه الأنفس وتلذ الأعين وأنتم فيها خالدون وتلك الجنة التي أورثتموها بما كنتم تعملون لكم فيها فاكهة كثيرة منها تأكلون إن المجرمين في عذاب جهنم خالدون لا يفتر عنهم وهم فيه مبلسون وما ظلمناهم ولكن كانوا هم الظالمين ونادوا يا مالك ليقض علينا ربك ونادوا يا مالك ليقض علينا ربك قال إنكم ماكثون لقد جئناكم بالحق ولكن أكثركم للحق كارهون أم أبرموا أمرا فإنا مبرمون أم يحسبون أنا لا نسمع سرهم ونجواهم بلى ورسلنا لديهم يكتبون قل إن كان للرحمن ولد فأنا أول العابدين سبحان رب السماوات والأرض رب العرش عما يصفون الله أكبر سمع الله لمن حمده الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. فذرهم يخوضوا ويلعبوا حتى يلاقوا يومهم الذي يوعدون، وهو الذي في السماء إله وفي الأرض إله، وهو الحكيم العليم. وتبارك الذي له ملك السماوات والأرض وما بينهما، وعنده علم الساعة وإليه ترجعون. ولا يملك الذين يدعون من دونه الشفاعة إلا من شهد بالحق، إلا من شهد بالحق وهم يعلمون. ولئن سألتهم من خلقهم ليقولن الله، ليقولن الله، فأنى يؤفكون. وقيله يا رب إن هؤلاء قوم لا يؤمنون، فاصفح عنهم وقل سلام، فسوف يعلمون. الله سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله.
Inshallah, we will have the recitation of the morning and evening du'as. Hafiz Mustafa will read a portion of the du'a, and all the brothers are requested to follow along. We will also have the du'as displayed on the screen, so all brothers are humbly requested to repeat after Mustafa and follow along. After that, we will have our Q&A session with Mufti Minhaj, inshallah.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم أصبحنا وأصبح الملك لله والحمد لله أسألك من خير هذا اليوم ومن خير ما فيه وخير ما بعده وأعوذ بك من الكسل والهرم وسوء العمر وفتنة الدجال وعذاب القبر أصبحنا وأصبح الملك لله رب العالمين اللهم أسألك خير هذا اليوم فتحه ونصره ونوره وبركته وهداه وأعوذ بك من شر ما فيه وشر ما بعده اللهم بك أصبحنا وبك أمسينا وبك نحيا وبك نموت وإليك النشور اللهم بك أمسينا وبك نحيا وبك نموت وإليك النشور اللهم أنت ربي لا إله إلا أنت خلقتني وأنا عبدك وأنا على عهدك ووعدك ما استطعت أعوذ بك من شر ما صنعت أبوء لك بنعمتك علي وأبوء لك بذنبي فاغفر لي فإنه لا يغفر الذنوب إلا أنت اللهم أصبحنا نشهدك ونشهد حملة عرشك وملائكتك وجميع خلقك بأنك الله لا إله إلا أنت وحدك لا شريك لك وأن محمدا عبدك ورسولك اللهم ما أصبح بي من نعمة أو بأحد من خلقك فمنك وحدك لا شريك لك فلك الحمد ولك الشكر أصبحنا على فطرة الإسلام وعلى كلمة الإخلاص وعلى دين نبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وعلى ملة أبينا إبراهيم حنيفا مسلما وما كان من المشركين. اللهم إني أسألك العافية في الدنيا والآخرة. اللهم إني أسألك العفو والعافية في ديني ودنياي وأهلي ومالي. اللهم استر عوراتي وآمن روعاتي. اللهم احفظني من بين يدي ومن خلفي وعن يميني وعن شمالي ومن فوقي، وأعوذ بعظمتك أن أغتال من تحتي. بسم الله الذي لا يضر مع اسمه شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء، وهو السميع العليم. بسم الله الذي لا يضر مع اسمه شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء، وهو السميع العليم. بسم الله الذي لا يضر مع اسمه شيء في الأرض ولا في السماء، وهو السميع العليم. رضيت بالله ربا وبالإسلام دينا وبمحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم نبيا. رضيت بالله ربا وبالإسلام دينا وبمحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم نبيا. رضيت بالله ربا وبالإسلام دينا وبمحمد صلى الله عليه وسلم نبيا. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من الهم والحزن، وأعوذ بك من العجز والكسل، وأعوذ بك من الجبن والبخل، وأعوذ بك من غلبة الدين وقهر الرجال. اللهم أنت ربي لا إله إلا أنت، عليك توكلت وأنت رب العرش العظيم. ما شاء الله كان وما لم يشأ لم يكن، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. أعلم أن الله على كل شيء قدير، وأن الله قد أحاط بكل شيء علما. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من شر نفسي ومن شر كل دابة أنت آخذ بناصيتها، إن ربي على صراط مستقيم. اللهم عافني في بدني، اللهم عافني في سمعي، اللهم عافني في بصري. لا إله إلا أنت. اللهم إني أعوذ بك من الكفر والفقر، وأعوذ بك من عذاب القبر. لا إله إلا أنت. اللهم رحمتك أرجو فلا تكلني إلى نفسي طرفة عين وأصلح لي شأني كله لا إله إلا أنت سبحان الله وبحمده عدد خلقه ورضا نفسه وزنة عرشه ومداد كلماته سبحان الله وبحمده عدد خلقه ورضا نفسه وزنة عرشه ومداد كلماته سبحان الله وبحمده عدد خلقه ورضا نفسه وزنة عرشه ومداد كلماته أعوذ بكلمات الله التامات من شر ما خلق أعوذ بكلمات الله التامات من شر ما خلق أعوذ بكلمات الله التامات من شر ما خلق
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept all the brothers who are performing i'tikaf. These are the masnoon du'as that were just recited. These are the du'as that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us, and he would perform and he would recite them in the mornings and in the evenings. And we should learn these du'as, make it a habit to recite for our protection, for fulfillment of our needs. Each one of these du'as is powerful in its own right. In this era of the pandemic, when people are losing their lives, people are severely sick, one of the du'as that stands out is Bismillahi alladhi, and begin in the name of that Allah, la yadurru ma'asmihi, that when his name is taken along with his name, nothing can harm. Shay'un fil ardi wa la fis sama. Nothing in the heavens, nothing in the earth can harm when his name is taken. وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. He's all-hearing, all-knowing. If this is recited three times in the morning, then nothing in that day will harm an individual unless death is decreed for him. And if this is recited in the evening before sleeping, nothing in the night will harm that individual unless death is decreed. SubhanAllah. What a powerful dua, provided it is recited with conviction. Another beautiful dua in this series mentioned is that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us that we have so many blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the shukr of those blessings is due upon us. To thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for each and every single blessing that we are enjoying from head to toe. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us that if you recite this dua in the morning, then you would have fulfilled the haqq in the right of the shukr of those blessings throughout the day. And if you make this dua at night, then you have fulfilled the right and haqq of the shukr of the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the entire night. What is that dua? Allahumma ma asbaha bi min ni'matin. O Allah, in this morning, every single blessing that I'm enjoying, faminka wahdak, they are all from you and you alone. La sharika lak, and you have absolutely no partner. Falaka alhamdu wa laka shukr. So all praise belongs to you, O Allah, and all thanks belongs to you. SubhanAllah. And likewise in the evening, you just change the beginning words, Allahumma ma amsa bi bin ni'matin, O Allah, whatever blessing this evening that I'm enjoying, they are from you and you alone, and you have no partner. So to you belongs all praise and all thanks. So what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves to see from us is that we attribute the blessings back to Him. We acknowledge Him. Instead of believing that these are our own rights and that we deserve these blessings, we attribute it, make nisbat of the blessing back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then we will have fulfilled the haqq in the right of the blessing, of the shukr of the blessings. Now each one of these du'as has its own virtues in similar manner. And These du'as were collected and were published by Darussalam, one of the publications of Darussalam, that we can pick up inshallah. So typically after Fajr, we have in our schedule the question and answer session. And we will be putting a box out in the lobby, inshallah, is where we can post our questions anonymously. And inshallah, we'll have a chance to review them and answer them daily after Fajr Salah. This is our first night. It was an odd night. Majority of us spent the entire night in ibadah. Moving forward, we'll be catching our rest, catching up on our rest during the day, and slowly our schedule will change where we'll be spending the night in ibadah and sleeping more in the day. The first night is always very tough because we have been awake all day and then awake all night as well. So we will keep it very short and brief today. Ideally, we would hope and expect that we stay up at this time up till Ishraq, up to 15 minutes or 12 minutes past sunrise. And then we perform the Ishraq prayer, which is 2 rakat nafal, and followed by 2 rakat nafal, 4 rakat total nafal. This is a specific prayer that Rasulullah ﷺ used to perform, and it has great rewards. For 2 rakat, Rasulullah ﷺ said, you will get the reward of an accepted Hajj and Umrah. And for additional 2 rakat, Rasulullah ﷺ said that you will get the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take care of all your affairs during the day. So these are two great virtues for the Salatul Ishraq prayer. This Salatul Ishraq prayer is not only for people in i'tikaf. Some people misunderstood me last night when I was speaking about Salatul Awabin. They said, oh, this is just for people in i'tikaf. That's great. We will do that. No, the Salatul Awabin is for people in i'tikaf, outside i'tikaf, all the time. But since we are here in i'tikaf, definitely we should not allow this opportunity to pass by. Our teachers, some of them would be making the Salatul Awabin all the way to the Isha every day, throughout the whole year, every month. And we will see them, subhanAllah. So we should make this practice of performing Salatul Ishraq. We inculcate that practice now in i'tikaf, and then we continue with it onwards, inshallah. I hope we had opportunity for all of us who are in i'tikaf to go over the schedule and to know what is what to expect, so we are mentally prepared and we are alert to participate in these programs. So alhamdulillah, before suhoor we had the salawat, right? These are very, very blessed statements. They are all proven from the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Each one of these salawat are means of drawing the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and in increasing our love of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is a part of our iman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتَهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِي يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. Verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the angels, they send salawat upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's salawat is by showering his mercy upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The angel salawat is making dua to Allah to send more mercy, further mercy. And then thirdly, Allah ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا, O those who believe, you send salawat upon him. This is such a unique command, the only command in the Quran wherein Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first mentions himself that he does so. Secondly, he mentions the angels do so. And then thirdly, he asks the believers, you do as well. There's no other command in the Quran with this nature. So subhanAllah, if you want proximity to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam on the Day of Judgment, in this dunya, people are very excited to be near influential, powerful people. And if you get a chance, depending on what your interests are, if it's politics, some president, prime minister, if it's sports, then a sports player, if it's the entertainment industry, some actor, and may Allah forbid, actress, or something of that nature, if you are very close to that individual, then you get excited. People like to take selfies. And in this day and age, with the celebrity speakers and sheikhs as well, people like to go up and get an autograph, get a selfie taken, that I was close to this individual. SubhanAllah. Imagine the greatest of the creation. The greatest of the creation. Ultimate greatest creation. أفضل الخلق أجمعين. Sayyidul Awwaleen and Sayyidul Akhirin. The leader of all those who preceded, the leader of all those who will come. Afdalul Mursaleen, the leader of all the prophets. Khatamun Nabiyyin, the seal of the prophets. Muhammadun al-Mustafa, the chosen one. Ahmadun al-Mujtaba, the one who was selected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This greatest individual ever, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine being close to him. And imagine being close to him on the day when everyone is in hasra wa nadama and regret, and everyone is in a very difficult position. What did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? Inna awlakum bi yawm al-qiyamah aktharukum salatan alayya. Verily the closest amongst you to me, when yawm al-qiyamah, on the day of judgment, the one who will be closest to me and will be near me in my inner circle will be those who sent the most salawat upon me. So if you desire proximity to the people of the world, people of influence today, the way to gain proximity to Rasulullah on the day of judgment, when it will matter the most, Rasulullah, his supremacy over the entire creation will become more manifest on that day. Liwa'ul hamli biyadi yawm al-qiyamah. The flag of the praise of Allah will be in my hand on the day of Jannah. Miftahul jannati biyadi yawm al-qiyamah. The key to Jannah will be in my hand on the day of judgment. Innal jannata harrimat 'ala al-anbiya'i hatta adkhulaha. Verily Jannah is haram upon the prophets to enter until I enter it. Wa innaha muharramatun 'ala al-ummi hatta tadkhulaha ummati. And it is haram for any ummah to enter it until my ummah enters it. He is going to be the shafi' of mahshar, the one who will intercede on behalf of the creation. When all of the rest of the prophets will have declared that they are unable, incapable of making shafa'ah and interceding, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam will say, "Ana laha, ana laha." That is for me, I am for it. I am ready for this task. So you will have the ultimate honor. وَبَعَثُوا مَقَامًا مَحْمُودًا الَّذِي وَعَدْتَ. As we say in the dua after Adhan, Allah will grant him the maqam mahmood on that day of judgment. And you really want to be close to him. And you don't want to be far from this greatest of all, the greatest of the greatest. And the way to be close to him, أَكْثَرَكُمْ صَلَاةً عَلِيَةً. To extensively send salawat on Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So is this any ordinary amal? What do you say? Tell me. So we say, oh yeah, they're just doing salawat. Wonder why they're doing the salawat program. This is the way of coming close to Rasulullah. We should be excited about it. What is the philosophy behind the salawat? The philosophy behind salawat is that if anyone helped us out in this world, proper etiquette and manners is that we thank them. That's why, you know, if you go to the hospitals, you see people bring, you know, flowers for the nurses. You took care of us when we were sick. People have thank you cards for their physicians. Even some lawyer helped you out in a legal case and you were getting sued and you were in difficulty and he saved you from jail time, people give thanks to the lawyers on top of the fees, on top of the, you know, $300 per hour. They thank the person who helped them out. But who is the one who did the greatest favor upon us from amongst the creation? Allah is the greatest benefactor for sure, but after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the creation, the one who has given us the greatest favor and we are burdened with gratitude to that individual is none other than Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What is his favor upon us? That it is through him that we learn the purpose of our life. He is the messenger of Allah who was a recipient of divine revelation and he guided us to the straight path. So how much do we owe him? And what is the way we can pay him back? We can send flowers to the Roda, address it, the Roda of Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Medina, and deliver the flowers. He doesn't need a thank you card. There's no way we can pay him back. So this is the philosophy and essence of salawat. We say, Jazallahu anna Muhammadan sallallahu alayhi wa sallam bima huwa ahluhu. That, oh Allah, since we are in so much debt to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we are unable to pay off this debt, the only thing we can do is that we ask you to further elevate his status and further shower your mercy upon him on our behalf. On our behalf. Because we owe him so much, we can ask you, what can we do? We can't do anything ourselves. So we ask you on our behalf, further elevate his status. So this is dua to Allah Ta'ala to elevate the status of the one whom he already loves. So definitely this dua will be accepted. And that is why we seal our own duas for acceptance by mentioning salawat in the beginning and salawat at the end. Since Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so Rahim and Kareem, when you will accept the first dua and you will accept the last dua, then he will not reject the duas in between. He will accept them as well. من صلى عليه مرة صلى الله عليه بها عشرة. Whoever sends salawat upon me once, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send 10 mercies upon him, forgive 10 of his sins, and elevate his status 10 darajat in Jannah. And there are many salawat, those proven from a hadith, those the people came up with their own wordings. These 40 salawat are all from the hadith. Shaykh al-Hadith, Shaykh Zakaria Kandalwi rahimahullah, has gathered them together, collected this collection, and he was the greatest muhaddith of the past century. And alhamdulillah, these are all masnoon salawat. So we should definitely participate and recite along with the one who is reciting. Then there's the Hizbul Azam. These are du'as of Rasulullah ﷺ that are recited and collected by Mullah Ali Qari, a great muhaddith and faqih. All Quranic du'as and hadith du'as. Du'as that pertain to our deen and our dunya. This is, what did Rasulullah ﷺ say about du'a? He said, "Ad-du'a mukhul ibadah." The actual essence of ibadah, the maqsad of ibadah, is to make du'a. Present your needs in front of Allah and ask Allah to fulfill your needs. Surah Al-Fatiha, if that is the essence of the Quran, then the essence of Fatiha is إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. Oh Allah, only you do we worship and only from you we seek help. Before that, you're praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and after that, you're defining what is the Sirat al-Mustaqim. اِهْدِنَا Sirat al-Mustaqim. That's the essence of Fatiha. Now, what is the Sirat al-Mustaqim? It is the Sirat al-Ladhina anta alayhim, and it's not the ghayr al-maghdubi alayhim wala ad-dallin. We're defining it. But the essence of Fatiha is إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ. This is the essence of Fatiha. This is dua. So dua is the essence of salah, essence of ibadah, essence of our life, essence of the purpose of our existence. Because وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. The purpose of jinn and ins is for ibadah. That's the only reason we've been created. So ibadah is our purpose, primary purpose. And the mukhul ibadah, the essence of ibadah, is dua. So the dua is the ultimate pinnacle. So that is why we should practice making dua. And dua should be something that is not just read. Dua is made from the heart. Dua is something that we are conversing with Allah. We are asking Allah, begging Allah. And we have to build up our resistance. Just like we had the fitness, Janwar fitness, right? Many of the young mashallah brothers here participate in that. So you start off with a certain amount of pounds that you can bench, then you add more weights, more weights, more weights, you build up your resistance. So likewise, we never practice making dua, we can practice, okay, I'll make 3-minute dua, then you 10-minute dua, 15-minute dua, 20-minute dua, half an hour dua, 1 hour dua. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it is approximated that on the day of Arafah, he was standing in the heat, and 6 to 8 hours, he continuously was making dua. Subhanallah. Raising his hands high, so high, حَتَّى يُرَى بَيَاضُ يُبْطِي, until the sides of his were apparent. They could see the sides. And he was wearing ihram. Until he got so tired raising his hands, then he would bring it down for a while and keep his hands raised. Then he would raise it high again when he got more strength. Standing in the sun, making dua the entire 8 hours, non-stop. Rasulullah, this is our master. This is our noble example. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. For you in the noble life, Rasulullah is the best example. So we don't have time because we have to rush to work. We have to rush for leisure activities, family, friends, social activities, pursuit of the material dunya. That's what we've been doing our whole life. Now we are in i'tikaf, stuck in the house of Allah. Are we stuck in the house of Allah or privileged to be invited in the house of Allah? Very different perspectives, right? We are privileged to be the guest of Allah in the house of Allah. If you're not going to make dua now, then when? You know, if not now, then when? If not on an odd night, in Ramadan, in i'tikaf, if the heart cannot be softened now, and if the eyes cannot shed tears, then I beg to ask you, when? Like literally, when is it going to happen, if not now? How can you have a more conducive environment than this? So ask yourself that question in solitude. That, O heart, when are you going to be softened? And O eyes, when are you going to shed tears? Allah Ta'ala says, أَلَمْ يَأْنِنِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَن تَخْشَعَ قُلُوبُهُمْ لِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ. Has the time not yet arrived for the believers that their hearts tremble with Allah's name? So this is something that we have to all practice upon. So that is the Hizb al-Azam with Wird al-Afham in the morning. Then we have the question and answer session, which is now. So this is supposed to be a more light session where it keeps us awake, more spontaneous. And it's very random, different questions regarding different things. Because at this time we're very tired, so it's a very light session. And then after that, we recite Surah Yasin, and we do, inshallah, the Salat al-Ishraq, and we take rest. When we wake up, then we have individual time for ibadah. We used to have a session before Dhuhr, we have removed that, so you have more individual time. Based on the feedback, people say, oh, we're supposed to recite 8 paras a day, 8 juz a day, 10 or 10 juz a day. We won't have different goals. How are we supposed to do that if you have no individual time? You always have a collective program going on the mic, and it's blaring on the speakers. You have nowhere to go and read Quran. So that's why you have time. If you want individual time, go ahead and inshallah, get up and continue to recite Quran. Do your individual ibadat before Dhuhr Salah. After Dhuhr Salah, we have Mawlana Ahsan Sayyid. Anyone is sleepy, he'll blast you awake, right? Trust me, those who don't know him, the students here, they know, subhanAllah. One of the most tedious subjects in the whole Alim program is Sarf, right? It's rote memorization of verb conjugations. Fa'ala, fa'ala, fa'alu, fa'ala. It is perhaps the least intellectually stimulating, definitely not spiritually rejuvenating exercises, which is a necessity. So that's why we have to do it, because Arabic is the key to the primary sources of Islamic Sharia. The Quran is in Arabic. Inna anzalnahu Qur'anan Arabiya. Right? The Quran is Arabic. Hadith is Arabic. So if Sarf is like the dry subject, this is the man who can make that exciting. If he can make Sarf exciting. So some of the students gave me the feedback themselves. I wasn't necessarily spying on the class, but they told me themselves that, subhanAllah, Mawlana Ahsan, he says, all right, a fi'l, do you know what a fi'l is? Right? He makes it so exciting. So so he will, subhanAllah, you will see that refinement of character, tahdhibul akhlaq, right? This will be the subject itself is so spiritually rejuvenating, and with such a powerful speaker, you don't want to miss it. And if you're trying to sleep at that time, good luck. It's not going to happen, because mashallah, he's jahwari yusawt, very mashallah, powerful voice Allah has given him. Then inshallah, after that there's some rest time, and then after Asr we have Mawlana Uthman Akhtar. Mawlana Uthman Akhtar is also a very, very beautiful speaker. And alhamdulillah, he was our director of the HIS program, and now alhamdulillah, he has joined the Alim course. He will be teaching the Alim Kitabs next year, inshallah. That's some new news for our students. Yes. And mashallah, he was an imam in Connecticut for 5 years, and he also has a degree in psychology, so he understands the psychology of the students, and he has extensive experience. He's a graduate from Darulum Zakaria in South Africa. He'll be going over Shama'il Muhammadiyya, the attributes of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. SubhanAllah. Who is Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? How was his day? How was his night? How was his face? How was his feet? SubhanAllah. How was his marriage and how was his life with his family? All different aspects of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, minute details of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, from his appearance to his character. This will be a detailed exposition of Rasulullah ﷺ, so that we can start falling in love with him, so we can start imagining him. And loving him, of course, is the first step to follow him, and following him will lead us to Jannah, inshallah. So that will be a very beautiful session after Asr. Then before Maghrib, inshallah, we will have an opportunity to do dhikr and a dua. Rasulullah ﷺ mentioned in a hadith Qudsi that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Man dhakarani fi mala'in, dhakartuhu fi mala'in." Whoever remembers me in a gathering, then I remember him in a more noble gathering, the gathering of the angels. Subhanallah. One of the shaykhs of the past, he said that, I know exactly when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is remembering me. So people start objecting, how can you say such a thing? You have the knowledge of the unseen? Right. Do you have the knowledge of Lawh wal Qalam? How can you say you know exactly when Allah is remembering you? So he said it's very simple. Allah Ta'ala says, فَذْكُرُونِي أَذْكُرْكُمْ. Remember me and I will remember you. So when I am granted the tawfiq to remember Allah, I know for certain Allah is remembering me at that time. So this is an opportunity for us to remember Allah in a gathering. And imagine Allah is remembering us in the gathering of the angels. حَفَّتْهُمَ الْمَلَائِكَ. The angels surround the gathering. غَشِيَتْهُمَ الرَّحْمَةِ. The mercy descends upon them, covers them. In fact, غَشِيَتْ means to completely cover, encompasses them. نَزَّلَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ السَّكِينَةِ. And the sakinah in tranquility descends upon them. وَذَكَرَهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي مَنْ عِنْدَهُ. And Allah will remember them in the company of His angels. So that will happen along with dua. Because we make our own dua as much as we can. And then if inshallah, we have one of the ulama making dua, it'll cover things that it never crossed our mind. I'll say, wow. Why? Because they're going to be making the du'as from the sunnah of Rasulullah. And that is before iftar. This is the time for when the du'as are accepted. لِصَائِمِ فَرْحَتَانَ فَرْحَةٌ عِنْدَ فِطْرِهِ وَفَرْحَةٌ عِنْدَ لِقَاءِ رَبِّهِ. The fasting person has two times when he's very happy. One is at the time of iftar, and one is the time when he meets his Lord. Why is he happy at the time of iftar? Many of the people say, oh, he's happy at the time of iftar because, you know, he finally gets the ruhafza or something. Right? That's not why he's happy. He's happy because Allah has accepted his du'as and he's completed in ibadah. And the du'as are accepted at that time. And then inshallah, after that we'll have the dinner, perform the maghrib, go have your dinner inshallah. Then we come back and we perform our awabin. Get ready for Isha. After Isha, we have the Amal of Tarawih. This is specific ibadah done only in the month of Ramadan. And it's a very unique worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We pray it with khushu' and khudu', focusing on our Tarawih, listening to the Quran being recited. And inshallah, after the Tarawih is completed, people may be leaving because they have to go back. But guess what? You are the lucky ones. Think about it. Don't say, I'm stuck here again, as I mentioned earlier, but rather I'm lucky. I don't have to run back. So let them leave. Whoever is going, let them leave. Don't worry about it. But we should stay back, inshallah, and benefit from some of the pearls of the Quran. What has been recited? So many ayat. Just a few ayat will be discussed every day, every night, where we will learn something, what was recited. Many of us, unfortunately, some of us may be understanding. Others, in vast majority, we do not understand what has been recited. And that is so sad. Allah Ta'ala has revealed the Quran as a book of guidance, and ask us to ponder and reflect. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. Why don't you not ponder over the Qur'an? أَمْ عَلَىٰ قُلُوبٍ أَقْفَالُهَا. Are your hearts locked up? Allah has mentioned so many ayahs and says, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ. So you may understand. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَفَكَّرُونَ. So that you may ponder. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَذَكَّرُونَ. So you may take heed. But it's going over our heads. So doesn't it behoove us and befit us to spend a few minutes? Are we covering the entire tarjuma? Absolutely not. Entire tafsir? Definitely not. Just a few minutes to cover a few ayat. And we have nowhere to go, so we should be part of that. And then after that, inshallah, we can take some snacks, we can rest, do our individual ibadah and tahajjud, and then we'll have the suhoor. 2:30, and repeat. Repeat, 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 until inshallah, our hearts are cleaned, our hearts are shining, and our ta'alluq with Allah is strengthened, maghfirah is secured, ibadah and Laylatul Qadr is secured, and we return home as a newborn baby. كَيَوْمٍ وَلَدَتْهُ أُمُّهُ. Like the day our mother gave birth to us. When we go back home, our family members should say, SubhanAllah, your face is full of nur. SubhanAllah, your akhlaq has been beautified. Your bearing has changed. Your outlook on life has changed. Your priorities have changed. You have brought nur and barakah into our home. You have not only changed yourself, you are changing the environment at the home. You have become a lantern, a light of guidance in hidayah. This is the objective. If you go back home and they say, what were you doing there? You're worse than before. You're even lazier than before. And, you know, you could have spent time with us, you wasted your time there. Then we know that, na'udhu billah, we have failed. We hope you don't hear those words. So, this is the program, inshallah. Is everyone ready for this? Inshallah. Now, inshallah, let us recite Surah Yasin. As I said, this was an odd night, first night, so everyone is extremely tired. Let us recite Surah Yasin. If people have the himmah to do some dhikr, then we can recite third kalima, Subhanallah, walhamdulillah, wa la ilaha illallah, wallahu akbar, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al-aliyyil azim, 100 times, salawat 100 times, and istighfar 100 times. What are the meanings of these kalimat? What is objective? I can describe that briefly, and it will take another 15 minutes, right? So I will keep that for the next session. So let us start the dhikr if you can, and we'll have deeper understanding after. We can. I will have some brief explanation to share with you, perhaps in another session. And inshallah, this should be done in the mornings and evenings, in itikaf and after itikaf. May Allah Ta'ala give us tawfiq. Okay. Anything on this? All right, inshallah. So you have Surah Yasin to pass on? Not anymore. Okay. So if you have a Quran, let us recite Surah Yasin. I will recite as well, silently myself. And you can recite on your own, and then we'll make a dua. And after the dua, then we are dismissed. Those who can continue individual may do so, those who need to rest. But one thing is not permitted, particularly my dear young friends. What happens is that we have this adrenaline rush, we're excited, you know, like a sleepover party. So what happens is that we want to stay awake. And when everyone is sleeping and we're talking, we're going to end up disturbing others. And we're going to stay awake, stay awake, stay awake in the sleeping time. And then what happens? Right when the program is starting, then we get knocked out. Then we want to sleep. Then I told you, I warned you about Mona Asan. He's a very, very powerful speaker. And then he's going to be disturbing us. We won't be able to sleep. And our whole schedule will be messed up. So actually, I strongly encourage people to go to sleep at the sleeping time. Don't continue to stay awake and talk. Jazakumullah khair.